To me, everything's about breathing, right? Like, to me, everything is about, like, take full ownership for everything, and then everything gets easy, because then you're in control. And then learn how to love to lose. I think that's how entrepreneurship, that's how life is. We all have losses. And so I like losses. I love adversity. I like the climb. I like the chip on my shoulder. I like when people are like, oh, I knew it. He's not that good. I want to build the biggest building in town ever by just building the biggest building in town while I think most people try to tear down everybody else's building. So I think positivity and good is practical advice to building an empire. And I want to be the poster child of the person that built the biggest, baddest empire and did it by being a good dude along the way. I want to do it and I want to be a rock star, right? Like, and that's where you influence people.
Do you feel like you judge yourself?
I don't. That's a very, very, very good observation. And it's what I want for everybody else. We're beating ourselves up. Like, everybody sucks at something, right? Like, we all have shortcomings and we all have strengths. And for me, it's like, why don't we just audit that? Like, why don't we just look at it that way and be like, all right, well, I'm good at this, but I'm not good at that. Like, and then I only focus what I'm good at, right? Like, I don't dwell that I can't fix shit around the house. I call somebody to fix it. Like, I'm not like, I'm not a man. I don't give a fuck. Like, you know, I don't get it. I also think it's awesome that I'm so emotionally stable and I'm the emotional backbone of everybody. Is that what a dude's supposed to do? Like these cliches, these stereotypes, they're so silly. You're exactly right, man. I don't judge myself. I'm fully in love with myself. But I'm also fully in love with everybody else too, right? It's not like it goes both ways. Like, I tell people to buy into me, that work for me, it's because I buy into them first. I don't need anybody to gain trust with me. It's there. Like, I believe that the human race is so grossly underrated. We are good. Of course we have some bad. There's 7 billion of us. But like, when you look at our net score, it's bonkers shit. Like, do you know how much damage we could be doing to each other on an hourly basis? And we don't? Like, we're still here. Like, we won. We're the alpha being. And we've figured out how to stay together. This is insane when you think about it. And yet everybody wants to dwell on, like, somebody said something mean. Like to me, it's just binary. Like, unless it's complete death blow, death to me and my 17 people that I give a shit about, like, everything else is super secondary. And let me tell you something, if you actually get into that mindset, it gets real good. Like, everybody, like, makes these big deals out of things that just don't matter. It's perspective. You know, my selfishness comes from my selflessness. Like, it's what makes me feel good. I see it in my mother. My mom is the epicenter to every single person in her life. Her sister-in-law, her, you know, cousins, aunts, everybody goes to her. That's her comfort zone. Me too. Ask GaryVee. Like this is my comfort zone. Like, I like this. Like, I hate when people are like, what can I do for you? Like, I say nothing. I don't want anything. I hate that feeling. I went into my family business because I felt like I owed it to, like, pay them back. Those are my parents. So if that's what I feel about them, what do you think I think about everybody else?
I know your mom, you've credited her with really helping to build your self-esteem, but you're also a huge believer in, like, don't fool yourself, don't tell yourself you're good at something you're not. So how did she make you feel so good about yourself?
She strategically used bullshit and real. What I think, in hindsight, she did was she overemphasized things that were subjective or good. So really, I'll never forget this. I opened the door for a woman in McDonald's when I was 8. Just, you know, we were both walking, we were a little ahead, and I opened it and let her walk through. If I tell you that my mom basically treated that event like I won the Nobel Peace Prize for like 3 weeks, but think about how smart that is. Like, think about how reinforcing that played out. That's what she did well. She made big deals out of the things that were tried and true. And then when I got D's and F's, she punished me. Even though she knew I didn't need school, in her heart, she made me know that there was accountability for things. So I would lose television and video game and friends privileges for, it would always be for a month. She'd break down somewhere around day 14, 13. My sister would tattle on me when I would sneak in TV. She really made me feel special, man. She really did it right. She really, really, really pounded home my EQ, my kindness. I've done it with Xander too. He went to the playground when he was two. We were at the playground. A little three-year-old kid falls and skids his knee, and he walked over and was like, "Are you okay?" And I made that like a two-week thing, right? Like empathy, right? And so she just really did a good job of making me feel good about the things that were around my kindness and my support of my sister and my leadership skills of my friends and taking the, you know, I took a bullet once for something my friend did in the neighborhood and she thought that was a good thing. And just kind of those personality traits that I think, you know, if all of us, everybody watching, wrote down like personality traits that we admire, anytime I showed any of those actions, she drove them home. And I think modern day parents and most parents do not do that. I think they focus on dumb shit like grades because they are insecure and they want to put the bumper sticker that their kid went to, you know, Stanford. Like, it's real fucked up when you really think about what's actually happening. So much of it is misery loves company or people reflecting of what's inside of them. Like to me, everything's about breathing, right? Like, to me, everything is about like take full ownership for everything and then everything gets easy because then you're in control. And then learn how to love to lose. Like, for me, my game's simple, right? It's all my fault. So now, I'm not mad at Lindsay or D-Rock, that's it, my fault. I'm empowering them. So it's actually true. My fault. Now, oh, we lost this, or this didn't deliver, or we fucked up. All right, so now, like, everybody's got losses. You know, it's funny, when UFC started getting popular, I started using it to paint the picture. I'm like, look, business and entrepreneurship is much more UFC than it is boxing. In boxing, a loss is devastating. Like, you know, I'm a big boxing fan, like most big fights, like the big fights through the year, almost, it's just unbelievable amounts of 33-0 versus 35-0, right? Just like, that's like what you do, you don't fight anybody, and you get to that level. Everybody's got losses in the UFC. And so, I think that's how entrepreneurship, that's how life is, we all have losses. And so I like losses. I love adversity. I like the climb. I like the chip on my shoulder. I like when people are like, oh, I knew it. He's not that good. That is like I'm even weirdly scared as I continue to ascend and I'm getting popular and what did you say? The marketing leading, like if people start putting these words in front of my name, I'm like, am I gonna sabotage myself to like recorrect this? Like I like adversity. So yeah, all on me. You know, I enjoy losses. Now all of a sudden, like what? You become completely invincible. I feel invincible. I really genuinely, outside of the health of myself and 20 people, feel 100% invincible as a person. I know what my intent is. I want to do good at nobody else's expense. I'm far from perfect, we all are. And so just easy, it feels very light to live life. I'm just in a good mood.
What is the impact that you want to have on the world?
So I would say this is my current POV, because I think it's actually important that I have a different answer for this at 50 and 60, because you're gonna adjust to the reality. I'll give you a good example. If something terrible happens in my life and it's disease-based or it's because some kid was texting while he was driving and hit my dad, those will become things that I wanna leave a legacy about, because that's just how we act as humans, right? They become your truths. But no question, this will never go away. I want to do the following. I'm fascinated by the same thing that attracts so many of millions of people to people that are selling bullshit. Those same people are attracted to me. And what I want to do is suffocate out all those other people and become the alpha of that entire world of people that are hoping and are desperate to look at me. And what I want to do is inspire two 14-year-old girls in Kansas City right now to build a billion-dollar company on having a bunch of employees hugging each other in the halls. I think that Steve Jobs came along, became an icon, but the sad part of that narrative was he did not treat his employees well. He became an icon, and the narrative became he got the most out of people by being a jerk, and that became romanticized. And a lot of people in Silicon Valley today run companies where they're mean because they think that's the right thing to do because they put Steve Jobs on a pedestal. I want my pedestal moment. I want to become that big. And what I want to come from that is that kids that aren't even born today think that they can build a $5 billion company and be a great guy or a great gal. I want to build the biggest building in town ever by just building the biggest building in town while I think most people try to tear down everybody else's building. So I think positivity and good is practical advice to building an empire, and I want to be the poster child of the person that built the biggest, baddest empire and did it by being a good dude along the way. And not everybody's gonna be happy about everything I did, but if it's 97% of people talking good behind your back, that's a real legacy. And I wanna do it in a pop culture way. I'm gonna do it anyway. People have done that before. Just so you know, there's plenty of people. Warren Buffett's a really good dude. Like, there's plenty of people that have done that. There's a difference. I wanna do it and I wanna be a rock star, right? Like, and that's where you influence people. You know, like, I wanna do it, but I also wanna be the most popular. And so then that person's like, oh, I wanna be him, so I guess I'll be nice. Like, I wanna literally take people who have DNA that's kind of nice and make them more nice because they think that's how I became big. So I basically wanna trick the business world into becoming kinder.
Thank you.